Are you making the right decisions, or are you just playing football without a purpose? Yo, what's going on, 1020? I hope you're all super well. Today's video is slightly different. There's not going to be too much. It's something I want to discuss, a really, really, really good news article that I want to bring to you guys, simply because today is a rest day. As you saw in yesterday's video, it's confirmed that we're playing a match with Crawley Town under 23s against some team tomorrow. So literally all I've been doing today is resting. I've been doing a bit of rolling, like just not much at all. And I thought, you know what, instead of just showing you some boring stuff, I want to show you something that might actually bring value to some of you. So this article that I found online is called 5 Key Steps When You Find a New Talent by Bruno Costa. Now, if you want to read the whole thing, link will be in the description, but I want to take you through it and give my points of view. So maybe you guys could click the link, of course, if you're on your computer, and watch it and read it while you listen at the same time, so that I give my point of view on the things as well. That could be pretty cool. Anyway, so this guy's head of scouting at San Jose Earthquakes, and he's had almost 20 years experience scouting as an academy director for Fluminense FC, Figueirense FC, and Syria, blah, blah, blah. And also a scout for the youth Brazilian national teams. He helped scout the likes of Neymar, Coutinho, Jesus, Marcelo, and William. So right here, he's talking about 5 key identifiers of talent for players in the ages 14 to 16 year old groups. Now, I've looked at them and I think it goes much higher than 14 to 16. How can you break something down to 14 to 16 year olds? It doesn't make much sense, but it's really interesting because some of these are just some of the points that my mentor always speaks to me about. So the first thing he talks about is being comfortable on the ball. Basically, are you comfortable with the proximity of defenders? If a defender is 2 meters away from you, 1 meter away from you, are you comfortable to receive the ball and play in that situation? Now, that can be very difficult for some players. If they see a player that's 2 meters away and you're facing your back to them, some players get very nervous at that and they have to kick the ball away or they lose the ball. And that's something he's looking for as a scout. So if he sees you and he goes, wow, this guy just is so comfortable when defenders are close to him, even if he's facing them 1v1. You as a player, it doesn't mean you have to beat them. It just means you're comfortable. You don't look nervous or anxious or like, give me the ball and just get it away as quick as possible. You take your time. If you need to take 2 touches, 3 touches, you can be comfortable on the ball by having 1 touch. I think it all comes down to your body shape, your positioning, and a lot of things like that. How can you be more comfortable on the ball? Literally just practice. The more you practice putting yourself in those situations where you have defenders very close to you, you're going to learn from that. There's no real individual drill you can do because it's something where you require actual pressure, not, oh yeah, I'm a defender, let's do a one-on-one session, you pass the ball against the wall and then turn me. No. This has to be competitive. You have to be comfortable on the ball. The next point is decision making. So here he basically talks about, do they choose the right play? Do they look to pass forward? How quickly do they choose to run or pass with the ball? Now, I think this gets mixed up a lot. A lot of coaches and even some players say, like, stop holding the ball, stop holding the ball. You need to make a decision. So if you're dribbling without a purpose, that is completely different to holding onto the ball, dribbling until you drag defenders in, because I think a lot of coaches see a player hold onto the ball and dribbling, dragging players in. Even you watch some of the top players, Iniesta, Neymar, they hold onto the ball. And Neymar, like, is a key example where he will hold onto the ball and keep it at his feet until a defender comes. He'll be 1v1 just standing like this for 3 seconds. Then another defender comes in, he plays the ball out. He's just dragged 2 defenders in, created a free man. So in that sense, he's made a beautiful decision, but some people look at it and go, well, why do you hold onto the ball for so long? There's so many things that we can get into there, but basically decision makings, are you making the right decisions or are you just playing football without a purpose? And again, to work on that, all you can do is just continue putting yourself in match situations. The third point is movement. How does a player move off the ball? Are they supporting their teammate? Are they tracking opponents' runs? This one simply just comes down to match analysis. Like, there's nothing else to it. Movement off the ball is something where I struggled with it. I wasn't getting in good positions. And if you're not getting in good positions, you're not going to be calm with the proximity of defenders simply because you're going to be receiving the ball in a bad position. After I did hours and hours and hours of match analysis every single week with my mentor, it was almost like it was a new game of football. There was space here and there was space there. And it taught me, especially as a number 10, I just stood in space. I didn't move. I walked a lot. I still do. As a number 10, if you put me there, I'm walking just side to side. I'm standing still sometimes, because the game moves like this. A lot of the defenders and players are moving side to side, and if you stay just still for a second, 2 seconds, 10 seconds, you watch someone like Messi in attack, he will stand still, create space just by doing that because defenders leave him. And then obviously we're looking at, are you checking your shoulders? Like, are you seeing where the defenders are? What is your movement off the ball like? Now this one is very, very similar to the last point. It's called tactical awareness. It's basically talking about how well do you understand the formation that you're playing? Do you understand your role as an attacking midfielder or a striker? In offense or defense, as they call it over there in America. I think that one's pretty easy to see in defense. I think that's the biggest part where you're going to get caught out as a player. If you don't know how to make the right press as a striker, you're going to make your team run a lot more than they need to. So I guess it's about understanding the tactics of that formation, how your team wants to play. If you're a possession-based team, do you understand where you need to be if the team might counter you? I don't know, I don't necessarily agree with that one. Obviously, it's a point you need to go into, but I don't really think it's in the top five. Let me know your thoughts. I'm not quite sure. So this last point, he says here that it's something they take a lot of consideration into when signing a player, which is body language. How does the player act around teammates, around referees, around the media, around fans? And if you have a player who is very aggressive around teammates, if I was a coach, I'd see that and I'd be like, why would I want a player who's just going to bring the team down? You want someone who can add something. And this is something, I think one of you guys said clout in the comments, and I've heard troops from Arsenal Fan TV say that people like Pogba and Lingard are players that you need in the squad because they add something different. It's like a hype environment. They change it up a little bit rather than it's like, oh, completely professional. You have to be focused 100%. They create an atmosphere in the change room and an atmosphere with fans. Of course, they're 100% amazing players, but there's something a bit different. They add value to the squad. I think for someone like me, I get along with a lot of the players. I make jokes with a lot of the players, and that's kind of like just me being me. I think when you get on that field, when you get in the dressing room, when you speak to fans, whatever it may be, you need to be yourself. As long as you aren't being silly and, you know, saying bad things about other people, be yourself, because that's what's going to help you grow as a player, but also perform on the field. So that is basically the five tips from this guy. Link will be in the description again if you want to check that out. Yeah, I'm sorry it's not a proper vlog, but literally it's a rest day. I don't want to show you guys all this boring stuff. I've done it before and it's just not as fun. So if you guys like this sort of thing where on a rest day, if I have nothing planned and you want to see me just find something to talk to you guys about, let me know in the comments as well. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts, because making a video every day is difficult. It's difficult to create content for you guys, but I do my best, and I know you guys are enjoying it, and you are going to enjoy the video tomorrow playing against some random team. I'm looking forward to it, man. I don't know yet whether I'm starting, whether I'm on the bench. Fingers crossed I get the go-ahead to start. That would be amazing. If I'm on the bench, I'm just going to be doing my best to help the team in whatever sense. Filling up water bottles, giving my jackets to people. Like, I don't know. Whatever I can do, I will help the team, because the team always becomes before yourself. And in saying that, I know one of you guys have always wanted to see my list of 1,000 benefits of being part of a team. So this first list that you guys are seeing right now is the 500 benefits of me playing any position in the team. Now, for a while there, my dad and I, and he will happily admit this as well, we both very much pushed for me to play as a number 10 all the time. If I didn't play as a number 10 and I played as a winger, we would come off the field upset, even if I played 70, 90 minutes. And my mentor noticed this and he's like, okay, we need to change this 100%. So he got me writing 500 benefits of being part of the team, and it helped massively. Like, right now, I really want to play as a 10. I think that's where I suit best. But at the end of the day, if the coach puts me as a 6'8", if the coach puts me as a 7 or 11, if the coach puts me as a 9, fullback, center back, goalkeeper, I'm going to be doing my best to help the team, because you're there to fulfill a role in that squad. And if the coach thinks that you can fit as a 7-11 or a 9 or a center back, you need to do that job. And right now it's like, well, I'm grateful that I'm playing. If I say to the coach, look, I don't want to play 6-8 anymore, I just want to play 10, my playing time would be massively decreased. So I'm increasing my chances to play as a professional footballer, which is awesome. I'm loving it right now. But you guys really need to take that into consideration when you're playing as well. Now, the second thing is 1,000 benefits of how the team helps me. So this was kind of tied into the same thing. I had a couple of problems with teammates back in Australia. Like, this was 2015, I think it was, 2016. and I wasn't getting along with teammates. And my mentor noticed this, and he's like, you're thinking about yourself more than you're thinking about the team. I'm like, no, I'm not. Don't say that. But I was. It was true. I couldn't believe it. When I started writing these things down, you start to realize, like, wow, the team is bigger than me. And the whole point of these is to change your perspective on something. I know people who have done these lists for some crazy things, which I don't want to get into, but it's very easy to make this list and take your mind off anything. It stops you dwelling on things, and you find the benefits rather than looking at the negatives. Now, as you can see, there's different colors. So there's like 3, 4, 2, 5. Basically, what you do is the benefit of a benefit. So let's look at the first one. It says, able to play, there has to be 11 players on the field. If I don't have teammates, I can't play. Then it says, means that I don't have to win the ball by myself. I don't have to run and win the ball back by myself against 11 other players. I'm able to train to create opportunities with other players. So I can train with other people. I don't have to just be by myself. Able to pass, not just simplify the game to dribbling. So look, they're not so closely tied. And as you get to 700, 800, you start repeating yourself. You start to like go on to things which don't even make sense. But it's the fact that you have 1,000 benefits there of like, this is why the team is so important to me. It's crazy, and I recommend you guys do this for anything. I've tried to get people onto it. It's a lot of work. Like sometimes I'll say, hey, write 50 benefits about that. And look, most people don't do it because that is tough. Try writing 1,000. But if you really want to change your mind and change your perspective on something, this is one of the most powerful things ever. So very educational video for you guys today. Not so much about my football, a little bit about my history. But I can happily say I've changed so much over the last 2-3 years. Ever since I met my mentor, I've turned from a player who was okay and didn't have the best mental state in the game to a much better player. A player who is very confident. Only my Australian fans will get this, but basically he got me from an NPL 2 team in the under 16s into an NPL 1 team in about a month or two. And then a couple months after that, I made it into the Sydney FC Youth League squad as a reserve player. Now, obviously that just wasn't him. There are a ton of other people like my dad who put a ton of work into that and myself, of course. So anyway, Team 20, I'm signing out. Make sure you leave a like on this video, subscribe if you're around here, join the journey, and I'll see you in tomorrow's video. Bye. Listen.